say it, I say it again, you've been had. You've been took. You've been hoodwinked, bamboozled, led astray, run amok.
That's part of the culture. You understand? Unfortunately, now the woman in the video that's going around, they call her the brick lady or whatever. Her name is Rhoda Osman. I think that's her name. And, you know, a lot of people are saying, well, y'all shouldn't justify what happened to her. No, that's a gaslighting thing. I'm hearing a lot of people say, where people are justifying what happened. Nobody's justifying what happened to the woman. Most foundational Black American men are not. People are just saying, hey, we're not in it.
Then you got Bushmeat Bucci out here pushing the false narrative that Tyreek is celebrating the assault on this Somali woman. Now, if this woman was FBA, you know, Bucci, he would have said, well, why is she out so late? He would have said, oh, she ratchet. She deserved it. It would have wound up being a full indictment against all foundational Black American women. He would have justified the whole thing. Then he would have used Glorilla and Sexy Red as the example of ratchet women. And he would have said, this is the repercussions of ratchetdom. But not for this Somali woman. Nope. Remember, non-FBAs are above criticism on non-FBA channels. Non-FBA channels are all about the demonization of FBA channels. That's that tribalism that won't let them dig themselves out of that hole over there in Africa.
You know, a lot of people are saying, well, y'all shouldn't justify what happened to her. No, that's a gaslighting thing. I'm hearing a lot of people say, where people are justifying what happened. Nobody's justifying what happened to the woman. Most foundational Black American men are not. People are just saying, hey, we're not in it. So there's this gaslighting thing towards us saying that we're justifying the woman getting hit by a brick. No, not one FBA brother has said that woman deserved to get hit by a brick. Not one. We're saying this has nothing to do with us. The interesting thing, there are people online saying that she deserved it. And you want to know who they are? Somalian dudes. I've seen several videos of Somalian dudes saying, yeah, she deserves to get hit with the brick. It's the Somalian dudes who's going in on her and justifying that. I want y'all to look around on social media. Look on Twitter. Look under the Brickgate hashtag. A lot of Somalian dudes are like, yeah, she got exactly what she deserved. A lot of Somalian dudes, they're embarrassed by her because her reckless behavior over here is basically her rebelling against her own culture. So she's coming over here to show out because she knows she's pretty safe to show out over here to a certain degree because she couldn't do that stuff back home in her homeland. Those guys are, you know, they don't, you know, they brick you down every day. So she's over here kind of showing out as a rebellious type of thing to her own culture. So when you look at some of the comments, and plus she's a dark-skinned Somalian, and that's another thing. Because of the colorism that goes on in their culture, she's looked down upon in her culture. In her culture, she's looked upon as less than. I'm hearing comments from Somalians. They're referring to her as a Jareer, and she's acting like a Jareer. They're using all of these epithets towards her. She's acting like a ghetto nigga. They're saying real reckless stuff about that woman and her behavior. You understand?
All right, let me address you women out here. They're saying that the men on social media is out here not showing enough sympathy and enough empathy. That we're somehow shaming, blaming, and victim blaming her. All right? All right, we're going to look at this from a different perspective. To all you mothers, grandmothers, and aunties that are criticizing black men on social media, all right, for our responses to shit like this, saying that we're justifying it, okay? From your perspective, right? This girl in her life has a mother, a grandmother, and an auntie that have been warning her. Girl, clubs, men, promiscuous, twerking, scandally dressed, alcohol, don't do it. Right? And she went out and did what? Men, clubs, alcohol, skimpy dress, twerking, promiscuous, and caught a brick to the face. Now she comes home, and she comes home to mother, grandmother, and auntie, right? Yeah, this is from y'all perspective, remember, right? Now, there's three of them. Grandma gonna jump up and be like, oh my God, my baby, who did this to you? Get me a towel. Then the mother, she gonna say, oh, we're gonna find out who did this. We calling the police. But then there's auntie. And you know what auntie gonna say? Told you so. Bet you won't take your scrawny ass back down to that club at 2-3 o'clock in the morning no more, will you? And auntie'll turn her sassy ass around and walk right the fuck up out the room and won't lose a minute's sleep, right? And she won't be accused of lacking sympathy or empathy or shaming or blaming anyone, right? Well, that's the position that men and the so-called manosphere take. We that auntie that been through it all. We done it all. We done warned her monkey ass. She went out there and did it anyway. And the only thing we could do was gloat. Told your dumb ass. That's all the empathy we got. That's all the sympathy we got. We might have a little more sympathy if it was our own daughter, yeah. But a stranger on social media that's grown, nah. Now, with my daughter, I'm going to take on all three of those roles. Oh, my God, my baby. I'm about to call the police, and I'm going to go look for that nigga. But at the same time, why was you down there? Didn't we tell you not to go down there? So, yeah, as a pops, I'm going to take on all three of them roles. I'm going to go through all three of them emotions. First, it's going to be like, my baby, oh, shit. Then it's going to be, yo, show me what this nigga look like. We about to go creep. Show me what this nigga look like. You ride around with your daughter behind the tent with the hoodie on, nigga, like, with the yam. And then after you get frustrated riding around looking for the nigga, it turned to, yeah, but you do know I told you not to go the fuck out there, right? So what was you doing out there? But daddy, nothing. You learned your lesson, right? Yeah. Where you gonna be at this weekend? In the house with y'all and with the family? Yeah, that's what I thought. So, leave men alone. We ain't got shit to do with it. And our sympathy and empathy ain't going to do nothing for her. Only lesson she going to learn from this is looking at them pictures of her face, swole the fuck up from that brick. That is the only lesson this girl can learn from that. This girl already got mothers, aunts, and grandmothers telling her what to do. And therefore, she got uncles, grandfathers, and daddies. So she ain't listening to them. What the fuck make you think she gonna listen to us on social media? Excuse me, anti-social media. We gonna laugh. She's a brick.
Yeah. You understand? So the people going in on her and justifying what happened to her are people from her own culture, which is something that's not being addressed. See, no, everybody's trying to drag foundational Black Americans into this mess as a way to deflect from taking responsibility and having a conversation within their culture. Why are y'all letting that be a normalized facet of your culture, that open abuse of women like that? That's their culture. Let's talk real. Let's have a real conversation if y'all want to have a real conversation. Them tether women too, because they don't want to have that conversation either.
Mm. See, y'all playing around. Y'all tiptoeing around this issue. These Africans, they come over here and they start to rebel from the country's customs that they come from. They openly rebel once they arrive in America. Imagine the level of culture shock coming from Somalia to America. Over there, you could be beat, you could be stoned, you could be burned to death right in the middle of the street with no repercussions, right? But over here in America, just the threat of violence, just telling a bitch, I'm gonna slap you, is an arrestable offense, right? The accusation of violence is enough. And she don't got to press charges on you. The state will pick it up if they have enough evidence, right? So these women are coming over here and have a whole brand new level of protection that they have never experienced before from their men, from their fathers, their brothers, their baby daddies over in these countries. The whole family could beat them. So now they come over here and this evens the playing field. So all the years of abuse or oppression by the men, right? Then they come over here and anything goes. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. That's an aspect we do not pay enough attention to. Because remember, a lot of times these immigrant women are scared to call the police because they're scared of deportation. All right? So they put up with a lot of abuse. But then when they come here, there's protection here. So now they come over here, they start clubbing. They start dressing skimpy. All the shit they can't do in their country. They start fornicating. They start being promiscuous. And then that's when they try to blend in with us and blame it on us. So when a lot of these immigrants come here, what they're doing is fighting against the westernization of their children. Now, it's easy to see the westernization in the boys, because the boys, they get in gangs, they get on drugs, they go to jail. It's easy to see the boys. The girls, they rebel a little more quietly. They out here having sex out of wedlock. They out here going to the club. They listening to music they not supposed to listen to. That dress she couldn't wear in her country, guess what? She wearing it now. So, like Tyreek said, yes, yes, these things are normal. They're more normal in these countries than they are over here. Over here, there's laws. Over here, you get prosecuted and taken to jail. Over in Jamaica, if a man beats his woman, who she gonna call? The shotters? Look at the state of Haiti right now. If a man beats his woman in Haiti, who she gonna call? The gang leaders? What, barbecue? And if an African man beats his woman, who's she gonna call? The Mzungu? And there's just too many tribes, too many chiefs, too many villages for anybody to fall under any jurisdiction for there to be any coded domestic violence laws over there. So, and she's a product of that. They come over here and all of a sudden it's like wide the fuck open. I could fuck any dude I want. Over there in Somalia, you got to meet one dude. That one dude you have sex with, you got to marry him. That's it. It's a wrap. That's your whole love life. Over here, you can fuck 10 niggas in a week if you want. And as you can see, that shit got her turned out.
Because they don't want to have that conversation either. So they want to try to do the all Black men nonsense. You don't want to tell the truth about the men in your culture because y'all still got daddies and uncles that can ship a brick over here and lay down and thump you with it. You don't want to tell the truth about the men in your culture because y'all still got daddies and uncles that can ship a brick over here and lay down and thump you with it. You know, those men in those communities, they get down like that. And for years, we're starting to call that stuff out. A lot of these women who come from these Caribbean and African cultures will sit up here and get in the media or get online and start pointing the fingers at foundational Black American men, or by using the term Black men. They understand when you use the term Black men, as opposed to Caribbean, Jamaican, Haitian, or whoever, Somalian, Eritrean, whatever, which is what they normally do. But when it's negative, they just go under Black, and they use Black because they understand that just the Black title is going to fall on us by default. That falls on foundational Black Americans by default. So whatever you say, hey, these Black men out here abusing women, everybody turns and looks at us, and then we have to be responsible for it. You see? Y'all remember some years ago, and this is why I was telling people, when you had those tether women like Fraudanista Jones and Tarana Burke and all of these women running around with white feminist groups talking about how Black men, quote unquote, are street harassing women. I was telling people then how dangerous that was and why they were doing that. These are tether women who are trying to come among us and point the finger at us for stuff that men in their culture is doing so that we could be targeted. Because I want y'all to understand, when they were running around with that street harassment, Black men are just harassing women on the streets of New York, they were trying to help these white feminists pass these laws, family. They were trying to help them pass these new type of stop and frisk laws where we were the ones who got targeted. They were going to use the tether women as their Trojan horse to bring in those new types of stop and frisk street harassment laws, where if a Black man's walking down the street, a white woman can say, hey, that nigga looked at me and I felt unsafe. And then they can hold up one of them tether mammies as their guard dogs to say, yep, I'm Black and it ain't racist. I'm Black and he is harassing her with his eyes. They were trying to do that. And we were calling them out for it. And we were letting folks know, these women are not from our culture. When people like Tarana Burke and others, especially Tarana Burke, was running around here talking about how she gets sexually harassed when she walks around, we had to pause for a minute and we had to ask some serious questions. We had to say, hey, wait a minute. What FBA dudes harassing Tarana Burke sexually? No. We just had to put on, we had to start thinking logically for a minute and putting two and two together. When weird stuff like that starts being said, like, wait, who, huh? So we start looking at each other like, hey, which one of y'all niggas hollered at Tarana Burke? Who's sexually harassing her? And everybody was confused. Everybody's looking around at each other. And I'm not saying this to be mean-spirited. I'm not saying this to denigrate anything. But that's when we really start asking questions about lineage. Like, wait. We wanted to know, who's doing that? Where are these niggas from? Then we start questioning her background. Where does she live? Okay, she must live in somewhere where there's some crack or some heroin or something. So we started to see, okay, she comes from a Caribbean background. So, okay, she's living in most likely a Caribbean community. All right? And now it makes sense. So we started to look at these people's backgrounds and see some of the funny style stuff they were saying and see where it really applied. And it really doesn't apply to us. But we get the brunt of it. It's very important for us to understand how we have to start gatekeeping our culture. We should have been doing it a long time ago. Brother Claude Anderson was trying to let us know this, but we're doing it now, so better late than never. But back to the lady who got hit with the brick, the Rhoda Osmond lady. There's an article, she actually, there's some funny style stuff going on with her. Back in 2020, she had another GoFundMe page where she was trying to raise money because she said somebody jumped on her. Another dude attacked her and she put up a GoFundMe. She raised like $4,000 or $5,000, allegedly. I'm going to say allegedly because it appears to be her on this GoFundMe. So now she has another GoFundMe. I think she done got like 17,000 already after this new attack that has gone down. Okay. So some people are kind of questioning this. This woman gets attacked, then all of a sudden it becomes a big old finesse for a bag. And so I don't know. A lot of people are asking questions like, what's going on? Now, she wrote an article, the Rhoda lady, the woman in the video, she wrote an article on Medium talking about her background. Now, she, according to her, she was born in Kenya, but her family went to Somalia when she was a kid, but I think her family was Somalian, something like that, and they were fleeing around Africa, and then they had to flee over here, and she was talking about how her sisters had to get forced female circumcisions. Yeah, there's an article. I'm going to retweet it and put it on my Twitter page. But yeah, she's talking about some of the weird stuff that goes on in her culture and the stuff going on with her family and how she stayed at a refugee camp in San Diego. And so that woman and her family, they've been fleeing all over the place. And again, man, with these people who have to flee and then they come among us and they're damaged and the dudes are damaged, the women are damaged psychologically, and then they get into weirdo behavior. And this woman, there's videos of her doing this performative dominatrix stuff with white men, and she's twerking around white people and dominatrix stuff with white men, and she's twerking around white people and arguing with niggas in the streets and some of these immigrant dudes. She's kind of known in these circles, and they say she's a known troublemaker. So they kind of have vitriol towards her already. So it's a mess. But the thing is, it ain't our mess. All right, y'all gonna have to be a mess over there, because we are just not going to absorb anybody's negativity. We got our own riffraffs to deal with. We're not dealing with everybody else's riffraffs. Y'all not going to hide behind us no more. Those immigrant cats, y'all going to have open conversations about why y'all busting women in head with bricks. That's on you. Well, FBA niggas do it too. Well, when they do it, nigga, we'll deal with them just like you're going to deal with these niggas that didn't hit this woman with a brick. You're going to deal with your people. I don't want to hear about what FBA dudes do. Y'all love, that's like what the white people do. What about black on black crime? Y'all love to deflect. You're not going to just drag us into the conversation. We ain't got nothing to do with none of this goofy stuff. And Foundational Black American Family, we have to stop letting people drag us into their trash. And let's be very clear. And when these tethered women and these folks get into these shenanigans, they'll try to pass it off as a feminist thing where they want to attack the men. They don't like the FBA sisters either. Because again, the old girl who got hit with the brick, there's several videos of her talking real slick about FBA women, talking about how the African women from her homeland, they got better bodies and all of this stuff, and they got natural ass and natural titties, and she just talking real reckless. Y'all can look it up. So that same vitriol is for you sisters too. It's us. They have a lot of vitriol towards our culture, primarily because these people feel insecure that they had to flee. That's why a lot of the comments are very vitriolic towards us, because y'all know y'all got riffraff, janky nigga shit that goes on in your culture that's goofy as hell. And y'all want to drag us in it, and we ain't in it. It's corny, it's weird, and there's a lot of contempt for us because we ain't really fleeing and doing all that weird shit like y'all doing. So there's this real misplaced contempt that people like to project on us. And we're saying enough is enough. We're saying enough is enough. Now, do we have a Somalian person here? Somebody has the name Somalian Pan-African. Let's hear what he has to say. Somalian Pan-African. How are you, Somali Pan African? How are you? Now, what city are you in, bro?
I'm in Toronto, Canada, brother.
Yes. So what's your thoughts on the situation?
Brother, I just think that what happened to the sister was unfortunate, but the problem is, brother, is that too many of our Somali women, they're into extreme feminism, and they're not modest anymore. And I'm not sure why. I think this whole, like, extreme feminism is a reaction with the extreme patriarchy or extreme clan system in Somalia. So that's...
Yeah.
But I just wanted to ask you a quick question, brother. Why are so many of these tethers, these vitriolic tethers, flooding places like Atlanta and Houston? Because this can be a very big problem.
Yeah. Yeah, well, you know, a lot of them are going down there. There's a lot of jobs down there, a lot of jobs in Atlanta, a lot of jobs in Houston. And again, they're all over Texas. A lot of people are just flooding Texas. There's a lot of job openings out there. And yeah, they're just going out there in large numbers. It's a very interesting dynamic. All right, let me get some more people in here. We got a lot of folks in here. Let me get our brother Afro Elite on real quick. And then, Rivy, have I had that name? Sounds familiar. All right, go ahead, Afro. Yes, sir. How are you, bro?
I'm going to say this. Nobody, no FBA man approves any man hitting a woman in the head with a brick. Nobody's saying that. And the thing is that there's a difference between people being sympathetic and feeling sorry for her. That's not what they're saying. They want us to take accountability. And that's where that's where we're drawing the line. We're all like, okay, we feel sorry for her. Don't get us wrong. But we're not going to sit here and take accountability for some third world violent shit that y'all brought to this country. Because there's, you know, you got situations of domestic violence. Don't get me wrong. But in America, among our community, that's like in-house people throwing cups and stuff like that. Outside, niggas don't be picking bricks up and hitting women in the head with bricks. That's not how we get down. So we're not going to make it seem like, oh, this happens in our community like that. No, that's their community that has stuff like that happen. So we're not going to hold accountability. We're not going to be held accountable for something that they have going on. We can feel sorry, but we're not accountable for that.
Right, right. Real talk. Thank you so much, brother. And again, dude, there's been so much disrespect for from the lady, and nobody's justifying anything, but nobody's about to run to the rescue for some tether shit that they ain't got nothing to do with us. And this woman does so much disrespectful stuff towards us. She put up a video. Y'all see the one where she had, I'm going to get my reparations, some of our reparations, where she's slapping a white man. And it's like some, you know, they kind of planned it. It's some dominatrix type of stuff. And she's slapping a white man for reparations. You know, that shit is corny, man. You know, don't bring our reparations. And don't. You know, just don't involve none of our stuff with your shenanigans, man. Just not cool. So all of the weird performative stuff that the woman is going around doing, well, FBA women don't do no shit like that. Let's just keep it a buck. FBA women don't go around here cosplaying and slapping white men on some fetish shit, you know, because she's doing it. It's like some kind of fetish cosplaying type of thing. Our sisters don't do that. And plus, our brothers ain't hanging around in these little dusty hole in the walls hitting women with bricks. Y'all not about to put that on us. Y'all not about to put that on us worth a damn. Y'all gonna hold y'all own nuts. That's something that y'all need to address in your culture. Y'all not going to do no game, goofy, dusty, buster-ass shit like that and then try to drag us in so that we can take responsibility under the banner of blackness while you sit back hiding your face. No, bring y'all ass, you and your little dusty braids, all y'all niggas who don't bring, come on out, and we putting it right in your lap. This is some Somalian Caribbean stuff that y'all need to work out. But nigga, that is divisive. You damn right. I'm dividing myself from dusty brick throwing niggas. Yes, I am. I'm fully dividing myself from that. I do not want to absorb your negativity. Rivy.
Now, did anyone hear Tyreek condone this attack on this woman? Or celebrate the attack on this woman? No, right? He said the harshest criticism that she's receiving is actually from her own community, the Somali community. Then he said black men don't hit black women with bricks. Has it ever happened? Yeah. You might find a crackhead or somebody that was on a drug binge. Two crackheads got into a fight over a needle. Maybe a crackhead black man hit a crackhead black woman with a brick. But that's not something you're going to see common over here in America. Now, to prove to you that it's common in these other countries, I would say, what was it, about 2 years ago in Haiti, I saw a woman get stoned to death because she was being accused of being possessed with demons. All right? I saw women stoning her. I saw men stoning her. I saw children present. So it's no surprise to me when you say someone from Haiti hit somebody with a brick. Just last week in Haiti, there was about 20, 30 suspected gang members that were stoned to death. Over in Nigeria, there's the Amnesty Nigeria movement called Stop the Stoning. So Tyreek wasn't lying when he said this is common practice in these other countries, right? It is common practice. Then there was a Somali woman, just like her, from where she's from, that was stoned to death for adultery. This is commonplace in non-FBA countries. I won't put this on Jamaica, though. Jamaicans ain't over there hitting their women with stones, but they will beat the bitch to death with a stick or a metal garbage can. So, yeah, now listen to Bushmeat Bucci's alternate revised account of events, right? I'm telling y'all, man, tethers like this are extremely dangerous, but I'm glad niggas like Bucci exist because we see that internalized, deep-seated hatred that these non-FBAs have for us. Before, you know, we was just trying to really figure it out, but Bucci, Brandon, Pan-Africanism Strikes Back comes on here daily to testify to you niggas how much he hates you. And remember, if he's saying that Tyreek celebrated the assault on this woman, he's basically saying all black Americans celebrating the assault on this woman. Because that's how that nigga get down.
So Tweek, he says, now this lady then got hit in the head with a brick. Zero outcry for the people who perpetuated this crime, who committed this vicious act to be brought to justice. Zero call, zero shaming of the men who did this. The only thing Tariq does is jump on the opportunity to continue to spread divisive rhetoric to fuel self-hatred. And I'm not going to lie. For as much as Tariq tells you he fights against white supremacy, I know that this is untrue. The only thing Tariq does is stoke the flames of black-on-black hatred, black-on-black animosity and vitriol. That's all I see. I don't know what you guys see in this dude. Tariq tells us about racism and white supremacy. He don't tell you about racism and white supremacy enough, as much as he tries to stoke the fires of division amongst you.
Yeah, this nigga's slow. How do you call a dude a race baiter that has a book called Foundational Black American Race Baiter? Yes, he knows he's a race baiter, Bucci. He's 100% committed to delineating and exposing each community individually what they're responsible for or guilty of. Yes, that is exactly what he's doing. But see, Bucci, you know what it is? Y'all don't want that magnifying glass on y'all. Y'all don't want the magnifying glass put on the tethers and their customs and what they're doing once their culture breaks down and they start to become Americanized over here. Y'all want the focus to stay on us. Y'all want to continue to shame foundational Black Americans. But if you were to delineate and you start looking at jail statistics, what Black men are in jail, all of this 63%, and if you break it down into these different ethnicities, then you'll start seeing 28% Jamaican, 25% Haitian, 13-14% African, and then that percentage of Black Americans will go down to about 20-30%. See, that's what's needed right now. Foundational Black Americans, we bear the brunt of all Black male crime, no matter what that man's ethnicity is. So if that's divisive, Bucci, then I'm trying to be divisive too. Fuck that.
I mean, just 10 years ago, I felt like Black people understood divide and conquer. We would always talk about that. The tactic that they use is divide and conquer. Now you have a Black man and other Black people who are trying to use the same tactic.
You notice how Bushmeat don't ever criticize any of these Haitians on here being divisive, any Jamaicans or Africans on here that are being divisive. Have you ever heard Bucci say, yo, yo, y'all African dudes, y'all do be butting y'all nose in FBA business. Y'all do be antagonizing them. Y'all do be getting caught out here on TikTok and Clubhouse with whole channels talk about Black Americans. Y'all need to stop that shit. You ever heard Bucci say anything like that? So the only divisive ones is us, right?
Divide and conquer. Because Tariq, he's just doing it on a lower level. He's just trying to divide you so he could conquer your pockets. He knows that he can have a little retarded captive audience who will send him money and support all of his projects as long as he makes it okay for them to hate people who look like them. Because we suffer from self-hate. So all Tariq does is, Black people already suffer from self-hate. Tariq's not responsible for that. But what Tariq does is makes it okay. He makes these people feel like it's okay to hate themselves. And in doing so, they go out and perpetuate hatred, practice hatred towards other Black people. Look what he says.
So self-identification, no longer allowing the dominant society to label you ethnically and to acknowledge your lineage and heritage above all others, while having respect of others, while demanding the respect for your own unique culture, is self-hate. Bushmeat. See? Yeah. Bucci wants the foundational Black Americans to stay on that flat Black plantation. They hate this delineation talk thing because they want to continue to hide behind the flat Black title. And if Black Americans pull out of that flat Black suit, it's like musical chairs. Everybody got hold their own shit. And they don't want that. They don't want the differentiation to be made. No, it's just Black. Let's just let everything be Black. But we already know when that nigga graduated college, Nigerian doctor. So yeah, that's divisive. It's only divisive because it exposes others, y'all. That's the only reason why Bucci has such an issue with delineation. Because it exposes others.
Practice hatred towards other Black people. Look what he says. The men, quote unquote, who did this to this woman were not non-FBA men. This has been confirmed. Foundational Black American men don't just stand around and let stuff like this happen. And that must be clarified. Did Tariq say, my heart goes out to this woman and her family? I'm wishing her a full recovery. I hope she's okay. Guys, this is not right. Ladies, go get you some Ogun juice so you could defend yourself from these animalistic men, because that's what we're dealing with here. We're dealing with animalistic men. Men who just can't handle rejection. Men who feel like it's okay to assault a woman because she doesn't want to give you her phone number. Listen, no one's been rejected more than me. Okay, let me stop lying. I don't get rejected. I just don't. That's you ugly dudes. But at the end of the day, rejection is a part of life. Your daddy rejected you when he went out to get milk 20 years ago and never came back. Rejection is a part of life. Why are there men who feel it's okay to assault women, period, because they've been rejected?
Now, you notice Bucci doesn't even want to entertain the possibility of calling out or mentioning any non-FBA men, right? He doesn't say, well, Haitian community, if you out here hitting your women with bricks, or Somali men, if you out here hitting women with bricks, then intentionally trying to hide it behind a flat blackness to conceal your dirty deeds, well, that's wrong. No, Bucci's main concern is, why y'all calling out his ethnicity?
Especially black women, because we know they ain't going to do that to a white girl. But these are the same men whining, crying, talking about they scared of the Klan. They scared of the police. Oh, the police is shooting us. Dude, you just as animalistic as the people you claim to be afraid of. This is why I constantly tell you, when black people try to tell me they scared of the police, they scared of this and this, I don't believe it for 1 minute. Because I know that there are elements within the black community that are just as vicious and violent as any police officer on any police force in America. Trust me, I know. Remember, my car just got shot at by a bunch of black dudes. What if they would have killed me? They wouldn't have gave a damn. Any police force in America. Trust me, I know. Remember, my car just got shot at by a bunch of black dudes. What if they would have killed me? They wouldn't have gave a damn. So when the police lays them out in the street, you think I'm about to feel sorry for them? Hell no. Because I know that there are those among us who will pick up a brick and hit a woman in the side of her face because she doesn't want to give them her phone number. We sit up and try to talk down on white people. We sit up and try to make it seem like white people are the worst thing on earth. Damn it, you've done everything you can for the past 200 years to be just like them. So everything that you say they are, you are that. Because you've become that as you've vied for their acceptance. As you've sought to secure certain intimate spaces in within their intimate position, in their intimate space, in their spaces. Everything that they are, you are. Because you have shaped yourself into what they are in an effort to gain their acceptance. So I don't want to hear this. Oh, this was non-FBA men. Get the hell out of here, Tariq. Tariq is nothing more than a vulture. He celebrates when stuff like this happens. He rejoices when stuff like this happens. Why? Because it helps him. It literally perpetuates his narrative, his message. There's nobody on earth who could tell me that Tariq is not grinning from ear to ear like the Grinch when he sees stuff like this happen. Narrative, his message. There's nobody on earth who could tell me that Tariq is not grinning from ear to ear like the Grinch when he sees stuff like this happen. Why wouldn't he be? This is everything he stands for. Black people doing things to each other so he could cover it and stoke the fires of division. Right? I'm not going to show. Lioness Den, guess what? You be in elite spaces and you've fought to gain position in those spaces. You've had to make some less than stellar decisions too to be in those spaces, because we know that you won't be allowed in those spaces if you get up in there and truly say what needs to be said. It's just not gonna happen. Something has to be given. Something has to be conceded for us to gain access to those places. And at this point, black people have given up so much, right? We've given up so much, It's like now we sacrificing each other and our children to this stuff, still trying to get the same thing, which is white acceptance. Come on, we all see Tariq. Tariq can say whatever he wants to. Every time he do something, it's a bunch of white dudes up in there. So we know who he's, we know who he's selling us out to. As much, I fight against racism and white supremacy. BS, dude. Total, absolute BS. This guy is celebrating this woman getting hit in the face with a brick, and it's really not cute. It's not funny. It's nothing to laugh at. And you got dudes out here talking about, she deserved this. What if that was your mom's? What if that was your sister? All the lady said was, no, I don't want to give you my phone number. All she said was, no, I don't want to give you my phone number. She deserved to get damn near killed with a brick, bro? Come on, bro. That doesn't even make sense. And you got tons of black people following this sick, demonic bastard. You got thousands of black people following this sick, demonic bastard. Thousands of black people following this sick, demonic bastard. People.
Particular video.
I don't care if I'm the first person to say this, but us Somalis are not black. There's a difference between African and black. Let me ask you a question. Are Moroccans and Egyptians black? Tradition, our history, our culture are so much more different compared to these other countries that are actually black. Josh Abiel, if you're not black, what are you? I'm Somali. Let me ask you a question. If you were to see a very dark Indian man, would he be identified as a black person or just an Indian?
Now, somebody needs to ask Bush Meat Bucci if that was divisive. Him saying he ain't even black. And this is a decades-long tradition when they come here to this country. They come to this country delineated. It's their culture to separate themselves from black Americans. So he's not only ethnically separated himself, but racially as well. He said he ain't even black. So foundational black Americans, we new to this delineation thing, and we need to catch up.
Content. Like skin. Skin. I had a time tonight. I had a time. So men weaponize respectability politics in the same way that white people weaponize it. So for example, if a white person was harassing a black person down the street and we find out that he's a doctor, immediate outrage. But if he was a felon, we wouldn't even know about it because it's excusable. It's the same way that like when police kill unarmed black people, the first thing they do is try to demonize the victim, the black person, and they try to go in their past and find anything that does not consider respectable to excuse that violent behavior. So we know it's not about the violence. It's about who you're violent towards. Which is why I wanted to discuss why Sukiyana was sexually harassed. Yes, everybody's saying that it's because, you know, she has vulgar lyrics and the way she dresses and the way that she behaves. And I think it does have a lot to do with all of that. In fact, I know it does. But I also want to point out that like black women have always been ungendered and over-sexualized in this country since the beginning. Like even in slavery, black women were in the field with the men doing masculine work, but then they came back to the barracks and had to cook and clean and try to avoid rape from both men, black men and white men alike. So we've always been ungendered, never seen like, oh, you're a woman, you shouldn't be doing this man's work, but always also seen over-sexualized. And there are so many women who have vulgar lyrics and who have a sexual persona, but this wouldn't happen to every single one of them. So for example, Saweetie, who has a proximity to whiteness, who's petite, This wouldn't happen to her. Imagine somebody pulling Sweetie's face over and over and over again and nobody being like, oh my God, save that petite woman. Or for example, Cardi B, who's married. She's attached to a man. I'm sure if that was Cardi B, somebody would have stood up like, no, don't do that to Offset's girl. You know what I mean? But because Sukiyana is dark skin, does not assimilate to whiteness, is not petite, and is not attached to a man, that's why it really happened to her. There are plenty of women who have vulgar lyrics who this would never happen to. Which reminds me of an example of like when Chelsea Handler, the biggest hoe I've ever seen thus far, went on Breakfast Club where Charlamagne, I don't know, he might have evolved now, but back then he was treating black women, especially women that he didn't deem respectable, like shit. And when she came on his show, he was respectful, he was kind, he was nice, even though she was mean as hell to him. This woman has made her whole career about being a slut and an alcoholic. She wrote several books and went on several comedy tours about being a slut, yet he never said one vulgar thing to her. Excuse me, Tokyo.
Big sub whooper in the bag, like what's up, blow the windows out of frame. It's a party when I pull up. Big sub whooper in the bag, like what's up, blow the windows out of frame. It's a party when I pull
up. What have I ever done to anybody in my life to deserve this? I never did anything in my life to hurt anybody. What have I ever done to anybody in my life to deserve this? I never did anything in my life to hurt anybody.
They jumped in the back of the Jeep laughing. We followed them, Polly him. He thought the hoes were Somalian. Probably when they hit the Holiday Inn.